pizza time!
Hey friends, I'm back with the second half of identifying all the color swaps for the Shredder's Revenge DLC. Sorry I had to cut this video in half, but if you would like to watch parts 1 and 2 as one complete video, there's a link up in the card above. Now, let's move on to Splinter. We got 87, action figure, movie, 03, 2012, and Rise. Then Palette 7 is not Archie, instead we have 2014 movie Splinter. Palette 8 is the Spirit of Splinter from the 1990 movie. Then 9, 10, 11 are Mirage Comics, NES, and Game Boy games. Easy enough. Let's get the last easy one out of the way, Casey Jones. We have 1, 87 cartoon, 2, action figure. Palette 3 is the 1990 movie with his black shirt representing the black vest he wore, along with the gray sweatpants. Palette 4 is obviously 2003 Casey, even sporting the bluish hair. 2012 Casey wears a sleeveless black hoodie over a gray long sleeve shirt along with gray pants. So here they gave Casey a black shirt to represent the hoodie, and he has gray arms and gray everything else to represent the rest of the outfit. Then for Rise, instead of using Casey's green color scheme from the Netflix movie, they opted to use the red and black color scheme of Cassandra Jones, Casey's mother. His hockey mask is even red, representing the red ninja mask she often wears. Of course, Cassandra Jones goes by Casey for short, so technically she too is Casey Jones. Palette 7 is Casey from the Sega Genesis version of Tournament Fighters. Palette 8 is his Mirage comic colors. Number 9 is his black and white Mirage palette. Palette 10 is specifically his colors from the NES version of Tournament Fighters. And 11 is Game Boy. Even though Casey never appeared in a Game Boy game until Game Boy Advance, which was in full color. April's turn. First is the iconic 1987 jumpsuit. Palette 2 was the Toon April action figure who came with the Channel 6 news van. This was also her alt color in Nick All-Star Brawl. Third is movie April. She has a maroon top and matching boots along with brown pants. This represents the maroon top and matching shoes with the brown skirt that April wore like for the first half of the movie. Palette 4 is 2003. Cleverly, they made the belt match her flesh color to make it look like she's wearing her crop top. Fifth is her Black Widow Avengers outfit. Just kidding. This is her black and yellow ninja jumpsuit that she wore in the later seasons of the 2012 show. Now for Palette 6, for some reason they opted out of representing April's Rise design and instead went with her 2014 movie design when she was played by Megan Fox. Palette 7. Well, I'm not quite sure what Palette 7 is. This could be a reference to that Mirage cover, you know, where she has the perm, but, you know, the hair doesn't really match here, although she does have the orange shirt and blue jeans, and, you know, the blue collar could be representing the jean jacket she's wearing there, but I don't know. That's just kind of a guess. I also found a couple of Archie comics where she wears something kind of similar, but nothing really stands out as specifically being this color palette. So I don't know what April this is supposed to be. If you know, please tell us in the comments down below. Palette 8 sports April's outfit from the notorious Red Sky seasons of the 1987 cartoon show. 9 is black and white Mirage April. 10 is NES, specifically from TMNT3, The Manhattan Project. And 11th is, of course, Game Boy. Now, we've made it to the real troublemakers, newcomers Usagi and Karai. These two don't just go way off the set standards that the other characters tried to stick by, but they also each have 12 palettes instead of 11. So, here we go. Usagi's first is obviously the 1987 cartoon, and second is his action figure. Now for the speculations. Third could possibly be referencing certain comic covers where his kimono looks more greenish. Palette 4 is red and brown, possibly a reference to Usagi's cousin Yukichi, who wears orange and brown. It could also be a reference to Space Usagi's red armor. Palette 5 is a white kimono with blue belt and black pants, possibly a reference to the cover of Albedo Anthropomorphics No. 2, the very first appearance of Usagi, which came out 6 months after the first TMNT comic and exactly 1 week before I was born. Palette 6 is green, possibly again a reference to those specific comic covers, also possibly a reference to Usagi's friend Kitsune, who wears green, or also possibly a reference to the Samurai Rabbit Netflix series. Palette 7 is orange and white, again, possibly a reference to Yukichi, or possibly to Space Usagi. Palette 8 is black with a white belt, most likely a reference to Usagi's enemy Jay. However, the gold sword handle could be a reference to the goat character Yagi. Palette 9 is a white top and red pants. Those could be the red pants he's wearing on this comic cover, and we can assume he's wearing that white kimono under all that samurai armor. Palette 10 is his black and white comic appearance, finally an easy one to identify. Palette 11 is not NES, but rather his colors from the 1988 game Samurai Warrior: The Battle of Usagi Yojimbo for the Commodore 64. And then 12 is Game Boy, even though Usagi never appeared in a Game Boy game. Okay, you think Usagi was a stretch? Get ready for Karai. Now, Karai wasn't even in the 1987 cartoon, so her default outfit is pretty much original to this game. The clothes themselves are based on her 2003 outfit, but the colors are different. And this is not the first video game to adapt Karai into the world of the 1987 cartoon show. And I'm not talking about Tournament Fighters, since that game is clearly set in the universe of the Archie comics. I'm talking about the mobile app Mutant Madness. They designed Karai to have a blue and purple outfit with silver armor and a red headband. It appears the Shredder's Revenge designers used those same colors but applied them to the 2003 design, which personally I think looks fantastic. Palette 2 is red and brown. The only thing I could come up with is maybe it's a reference to the Elektra type outfit that she wears in The Last Ronin. But then I decided to ask Turtle Nexus, and he pointed out that this is the color scheme of the original Mirage Foot Clan. So that's probably what this is actually a reference to. Palette 3 is black with a red belt. I believe this is representing her 2007 movie appearance. It may also be referencing her 2014 or even 2016 movie appearances too. Palette 4 is obviously her 2003 appearance, though if you ask me, the bright colors look much closer to her Turtles Forever straight-to-TV movie appearance. Palette 5 is a black outfit under silver armor with a purple belt. This is referencing the 2012 show. Palette 6 is her Sega Genesis Tournament Fighters outfit. Palette 7 sports her Super NES Tournament Fighters Player 2 colors, while Palette 8 sports her Player 1 colors. Now, here's where things get really messy. Skip to Palette 10, which is Mirage, and then 12 is Game Boy. Easy peasy. But what about 9 and 11? I've searched tons of cartoons, comics, and action figures, and haven't found any Karai outfits that look like these. Let me know in the comments if you know of times that she's worn these colors. Honestly, I was a little annoyed that they completely skipped over the green color scheme from Rise of the TMNT. I think it could have looked cool. Anyway, the best I can come up with is that these are references to other retro ninja video games. Palette 9 sports the colors of Joe Musashi from the Shinobi series, while Palette 11, which is in the NES style, very much makes me think of Ryu Hayabusa from Ninja Gaiden. What do you guys think? Let us know down in the comments section. Now that's all the playable characters, but we can't forget the big man himself, Final Boss Super Shredder. He now wears black instead of purple. This goes all the way back to the early 90s. There was a Chef Boyardee promotion that kids could mail away to receive this exclusive black variant action figure of Super Shredder. This is now a very rare item sought after by many collectors. It's been recently referenced by modern toy companies Super 7 and NECA, the latter of which has officially dubbed him Super Shredder Shadow Master. So it's super cool to get this obscure figure finally canonized in a video game story. So, that's all, friends. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe if you haven't already. There's links in the video description to join my Discord, Instagram, or even Patreon if you want to support this channel. And for the 100th time, please share your thoughts in the comments below. Have a fantastic Turtly Tuesday, and toast!